Hello, everyone. So my topic is going to talk about building an effective approach to migrate from Thrift to SQL. The reason why I'm talking about this is because based on our own working experience. And so I work for a company called the Pythian Group. And Pythian Group is mainly focused on IT service, project consulting, solution consulting, managed service as well. We started from doing a lot of consulting for Oracle. And then in recent years, we touched areas in NoSQL, big data, data science, and so on. So our motto is just love your data. And we have a kind of very top talent DBAs across the world. And we have 9 Oracle ACEs, 2 Microsoft MVPs, and 1 Cassandra MVP. And we are golden partners with DataStax and Platinum partner with Oracle, and golden partner with Microsoft and some other companies as well. So as I said, our specialties is database, cloud, DevOps, big data, advanced analytics. So for the industry recognition, for the latest database trend and applications, we are kind of marked as the top 100 companies that matters most in data. And we are also ranked as the Global Outsourcing 100 Rising Star for 2016. So pretty much, we have a very strong footprint in the IT consulting and community. So about myself, I started my career as like a client application developer, and it's been more than 16 years so far. And but my focus is always on the data side. I have been working as a DB2 kernel developer for new development for 5 years, and I get involved in the different versions of DB2. My specialty is locking and pretty much database locking and deadlock detection. That is my specialty. And after that, I work a few years like in different BIA areas. And now my recent focus is on NoSQL and distributed computing. So here's my LinkedIn profile and Twitter account. And if you'd like to get in touch, and feel free to send me invitations. Okay, so without further ado, we'll just start with today's agenda. So I'd like to start with, what is the current problem, and based on our experience, and a little bit of background discussion related with this presentation, and then a little bit of history and reasoning why Thrift to SQL transition is needed, part of this discussion will covers a lot of underlying storage engine details regarding why we need to do this way. And after that, we are going to present an approach of how to migrate data, which is your application, your existing application has built some data out of Thrift protocol or applications. Now, how you migrate those data into SQL realm. So after that, we conclude with some kind of, if we have time, we'll have a very brief Q&A session. So problem, based on our old experience, we've seen many customers started with using Cassandra with a very with the lower versions of Cassandra, for example, 1.2. And with that fact, their application is written in Thrift protocol. But the fact is that right now, Thrift protocol is going to deprecate. And it's not actively supported already. And by version 4, it will be removed completely. So the very urgent, in my opinion, the very urgent problem that many customers are facing, how are they going to migrate from Thrift to SQL efficiently? So I'm going to use one particular example that I dealt with one of our customers. So the customer asked to do the migration from 1.2 to 2.1. Of course, we did a intermediate upgrade to 2.0 first because the incompatibility between 1.2 and 2.1. So their application is Thrift based. They use the Hector based closure language, and they wanted to start testing some of the new features, so they built a new cluster, which is I call it a dev test cluster, which is smaller cluster having 3 nodes, and their production nodes having 12 nodes. Then they wanted to copy some of the data over. Now, because of the data size is small, like a couple of 100 gigabytes, and so as we say, okay, the easiest way is to use a Cassandra copy command. So from the production environment, we do the copy to and into like a CSV file, then just transfer the CSV file to the dev cluster, then from there we do the copy from. But the problem is, once we do the copy and they test the application against the new cluster, and suddenly the application complains, some data cannot be found. Well, the first reason, first reaction that we did is, is there any kind of a data copy issues? We just, log into the CQL shell command on both clusters. We just investigate into the schema and compare with do some data sampling. Everything is fine. Everything is exactly the same, but the application complains. So why? So this is, we spend like a, so we have kind of two situations here. The first thing is, we have to let the application be happy. Then we have to figure out a different way to copy the data. And the second thing is, which is more important, is how are we going to solve this issue? So the easy approach that we took is, we just throw the copy command. We actually do a SS table copy directly from production to dev and test cluster. Then we do the SS table loader, because we know that the SS table loader is going to guarantee everything, because it ignores the replication factor, ignores the topology. It will make everything just perfect work. We did that, and then problem solved. But we still don't know why the previous copy command doesn't work. So after some deeper investigation, we realized that this is because of their Thrift protocol. And somehow they have this mixed column family definition, so which means I will go to the details later. But how I writing this presentation, because I do feel that in the operational field, many customers are facing these issues. So this is my attempt to try to. Just present some of the findings shared with the community. So when customers are facing similar issues, they have a way to figure out. So just some very quick background discussion. I'm pretty sure you are all aware of this. I'll just very quickly go through it. So the copy command we use is just copy from a table. You specify the column names, and you specify either to or from with some options. So this command is available since very early of Cassandra. It is actually mirroring the PostgreSQL copy commands. It is simple and it can be very convenient for some times, but it has some limitations. For example, it only limited to a small data set, maybe like a few million rows maximum. And then if you do the copy to, the output format is test format, CSV file. And when you do the data loading from copy command, there's no primary key check. So assuming you have like a duplicate key, a duplicate role for the same key in the CSV file you want to load, then using copy command could give you some trouble and headaches in the later. So that is just something you have to be aware of. But the thing is, because of its convenience, it is still under continuous development. And especially with the newer releases of Cassandra, It has added a lot of options to improve performance, to give you more flexibilities, and you will find it's, you know, it's all, you know, you can Google it, you know, with all the options. So I'm not going to go through details. But the thing is, you know, if you want to use a copy command, you have to have a predefined schema. So which means, you know, that makes sense because, you know, I'm going to specify a table name here. If you don't have the big schema, how can I use it? So this is, you know, this is related to with the failure that we face with the customer. I'm going to talk about this later. So some other background discussion about, you know whether we should, you know, many NoSQL DBs is marked as a schemaless. And some people think it's a good thing, and some people think it's an evil thing. So there's a lot of debate on that. But my personal view on this, I'm always like a schema person, you know, because that kind of defines your application logic and reflecting your business model, right? So for Cassandra, in my view, that if you are going to use the Thrift protocol and Cassandra is a schema optional, which means you can either specify schema or you cannot. Like you have the choice to do either way. But if you are going to use a SQL-based protocol, it is always a kind of a schema required. So that is very obvious, right? So some other background discussion, because in my explore of the database engine, and to explain the difference between Thrift and SQL, I'm going to use a lot of Cassandra CLI utility because this is a great utility. Actually, it reflects the database engine. I have to point out that, you know, the database engine that I'm talking about is a pre 3.0 database engine, because in data 3.0, the database engine is, you know, heavily rewritten, and some of the topics doesn't apply to the newer version. The right side is just, you know, how you're gonna use the Cassandra CLI utility to write and read data. And I also use the SS table to JSON utility and to show some subtle difference of the storage engine component. So you all know this utility, so I'm not going to explain it. And when it comes to the slide, you will see how this is going to show you the storage engine details. So like the question is, you know, what is really Thrift and SQL? Like, right, Thrift is kind of a general framework. It's not like limited by Cassandra itself. It has majorly two components. One is the interface definition language, and the other is a communication protocol. Both, you know, Thrift and SQL, and you can think of as a, you know, in a simple way as the APIs to interact with the Cassandra engine. And SQL is also a query language. Well, Thrift is also is a interface definition language, but I don't treat it as a query language like SQL or the traditional SQL, because it doesn't provide the similar functionalities. So this is my view on how this data Cassandra data is accessed via these two different protocols, right? So in very early stages, you know, we have this Thrift protocol layer, and really there's no, you know, abstraction regarding how to access the data. You know, there's really no query language. And then we have the SQL query language, but it is on top of the Thrift protocol. It is kind of a mixed version. And then with the involvement of Cassandra, then we have the SQL query language on top of the SQL binary protocol. So in the so these two together, I will call it as a simple as a, like a SQL 3, and which is the most SQL we use right now. So, but you have to like keep in mind that there are two parts of it. One is a query language, and another is a binary protocol. So here is some you know, background knowledge of this Thrift and history, and it just like, you know, pretty much, you know, Thrift in Cassandra, it starts very early of the Cassandra. And it's a low-level API. It is RPC-based. It's synchronous. And the SQL is a kind of asynchronous mechanism. So in theory, it could be like a performance could be better, right? But there's a kind of a trick. You know, if you use a SQL with the pre 3.0 engine, sometimes the performance can be worse. But if you use a SQL with like a 3.0 onwards engine, performance is much better. And the SQL is also a language, and it provides like new features like UDF, lightweight transaction, JSON support, materialized views. So you can see that the trend is that, you know, SQL is getting more and more support in the industry world, right? But Thrift pretty much stopped there. And even from a driver perspective, there's no continuous support for a Thrift driver. You know, Hector is kind of stopped being developed, and the Netflix, the Thrift-based Java application package is also, you know, stopped being supported. So you can see that kind of SQL is kind of replacing Thrift in series. So having said so, you know, if we want to do a Thrift to SQL transition, what can we do? What really need to be done? And in my opinion, there are four areas. You know, first is the application. Of course, you have to change your application code, and, you know, to meet the SQL standard. And also because of the impact on the data model side, you may have to tweak your data model a little bit. And another thing is about the data itself. And my focus would be on the data itself and the storage engine part. I will touch a little bit on the data model side, but the focus of this presentation is on the data itself and the storage engine. So like for pre 3.0, this is the kind of very high level abstraction of the storage engine. So you have, it is kind of a map of a sorted map. And you have the row key at the, then for the row key, you have a sorted map of a bunch of, you know, columns and a bunch of, you know, column key and value maps as well. So this is, you know, is well known. And some people, they use a super column. It is just at another level of the map. So it doesn't change the, you know, understanding here. So I just, for simplicity, I just remove the super column out of the picture. Just use the very basic, you know, map of sorted map kind of representation. So having such an understanding, then if we look at the create a table called a sum tag, you know, it has a primary key as an ID, and then has a tag name as a, you know, a clustering key. And notice that, you know, we have the compact storage here, and I will have one slide just for this, and so I will talk that in more detail later. So this is, you know, this is how I use the tools like Cassandra CLI and SQLS output to compare the storage engine from between the Thrift and the SQL. So if you can see, in Thrift mode, and you have a row key, and then you have a row, and you know, for each row, they has a column name and a column value, and it's timestamp. But if you look at the corresponding SQL output, it actually splits into two rows. So here's a little bit of confusion between many, like that causes among many people. So here's what I kind of gave some kind of definition. So when we talk about table in Thrift, it's normally called as a column family. In SQL world, we call it table. But, you know, we can kind of, interchange these two terms. You know, for simplicity, I just use table as, you know, to mean in both Thrift and the SQL worlds. And for row, there's a lot, is a big difference. You know, in Thrift, if you see a row, it is a partition. Right, but in SQL, if you look at the representation here, it is just a part of the row. It is a part of the partition. So just in order to avoid confusion, you know, I actually call it, you know, give it the storage role or partition or the logic role or the part of the partition, right? In column, kind of the concept is kind of similar, but sometimes in Thrift, it is called as a cell. But you know, in SQL world, you won't see this term a lot. Just keep this like in mind. So this is a compact storage. Why this you know makes a difference? So if you define a table without a compact storage, which is a default way as in the old Thrift world, then you see here. So you just compare these two parts. You see that with no compact storage, actually in the data side, it actually uses more space because it has the grid, which is a column name. It's a column value. But in the traditional Thrift way, there's no such metadata. It's just like all values compacted in tightly together. So from a storage perspective, if you use Thrift application or Thrift-based definition of a table, you save a lot of storage space, especially if you are dealing with wide column row. But I think most people may be thinking, okay, so the Thrift the storage is not a big deal. So we like to keep more metadata in the stored in the data format. Then when we have retrieved the data, it is more expressive. So it is up to you. But if you are going to use the compact storage, and there's a couple of limitations. For example, if you are going to define a table above as with compact storage, you are not going to add and drop columns further. And if you have a compound primary key, then you can only have one non-primary key column. So also, if you are going to define a collection in the table, then the collection has to be defined as frozen. This is the So there's some kind of so here is what I make a differentiation of three unique cases. One is called a static table definition, and in the static static definition, and you define the column metadata, and the equivalent definition in SQL is on the right side. You have to remember the with compact storage option. So there's no problem with this stacked table definition. So this is a dynamic table definition. If you can see that in Thrift, there's no metadata definition, but in the actual data, we do have some kind of a column, columns there. And this is based on the Thrift kind of a schemaless nature. But even so, for this for pure dynamic table definition, there's also no problem when we do the transition from Thrift to SQL. The problem comes from the mixed model. So if you define a Thrift as like a column metadata, but your application is going to add some columns dynamically. So for one partition, you add like three extra columns, but for another partition, there's none. So in this case, if you are going to look at the table in SQL, you are only going to see those metadata columns. Those extra added columns are gone. So this is a problem where our customer faces, because their applications dynamically add some columns, but they have some metadata defined in their schema. So then when we do the copy command, then suddenly those dynamic values are gone. So this is a problem, and we want to solve it. So what we take here is, when you do the Thrift data migration to SQL, do not fully trust your Cassandra schema, especially if you use a show schema or the describes key space and give you some kind of output. and list all the columns, they may not tell you all the stories there. And for older versions of Cassandra, you have the Cassandra CLI command that is, you know, you should use. And if you are going to use the CQLS, because CQLS is CQL-based, so it has the same problem as, you know, not being able to show those extra dynamic data. And then you need to like review application and to see if there's any kind of data model changes needed. And then the final step would be define a method to actually migrate the data. So my approach is, I just, suppose we have a definition of table with a mixed definition. And then we have a static column set and the dynamic column set. And then we can do is, we can define a SQL table, all these static column as there by its own as a column. And then we actually define a map column, which is covers all the dynamic columns. So this is not necessarily true for everyone, but it's a kind of like general approach, that can be applied to many different situations. So the approach is, once we define the data, the schema in the SQL side, then we are going to do the ETL. And we actually try for our customer, we tried two approaches. One is just, read every record from the source table and write in the target table. This is very, very slow because for every single row you read, you have to go through the Cassandra read and write path, right? So it's a lot of a headache. So we are kind of trying to figure out, like, is there kind of a data loading utility like relational database? And which is, SS table loader. But SS table loader requires, you have a bunch of SS tables to work with. And then how are we going to generate those SS table files? So we use this Cassandra engine code called SQL SS table writer. And pretty much, this is a pseudo code. And we are going to define a writer, then we are going through all these thrift, connections. And then we check if this column is a static column or dynamic column. If it's a dynamic column, we throw into the map. And once this the iteration is done, we are going to write this, we call this write add row, and of this SS table writer, which will bypass all this Cassandra write path and generate the SS table directly. So this approach is actually very, very efficient. So this is in the result that we did. We actually processed about like 1.2 million rows in just 35 seconds. We kind of generate a bunch of SS tables covering the source table. Then we do the SS table loader like in another like less than one second. And like in less than 5 seconds, we actually finished the ETL. And we actually keeps all the dynamic data and saves it into the SQL table. So conclusion is, Cassandra is really moving on from Thrift to SQL. So please do it because it will be out of the picture very soon, sooner than many people think. And when you do the migration, do not fully trust the schema that as returned by the Cassandra tools. They may not tell you everything. We do have the Cassandra do have the load utilities, and this approach, what I described here, this storage engines only applies to pre 3.0 version. 3.0 has a lot of changes in storage engine. I may have to have another kind of post related with how to do with 3.0. So I actually have a blog post describing all this situation, and you can find it from here. So pretty much, that's all. Do you have any questions? Okay, so the question is if the static column is a relatively small number, and the dynamic column is kind of a relatively large number, and is there a The thing is, okay, the thing is in the dynamic column, you know, each row or each partition may have different numbers of dynamic columns. So that the dynamic column set that I list in the slide is actually applies to all partitions, so all every single cases. So in that case, it's really hard to figure out, you know, which dynamic column is really is there, unless you have to go through all the, you know, application code details. So it's really hard, especially, you know, if there's 1,000, you know, dynamic columns, you know, I would doubt it's very, very hard for you to figure out how many dynamic columns there really are. So my approach is just focus on the static columns and let the Cassandra deal with the rest of the, you for, yeah, like map or maybe, you know, or even other, you know, like collection types. Could be, like, but map would be the natural fit. So, there, okay, so there, the, if you define the map as a frozen type, then the entire map is stored as a kind of a blob as a whole. But if you do not use it as a frozen, it is kind of as a, you know, the map name and then the colon, then map value stored like that way. It's very similar to the how you store the clustering columns. You know, if you see the clustering column, it's a kind of a column value, then a column, then some other, you know, non-primary key column names, right? Something like that. Thank you.